Hey everybody, I'm Sam and this is Antiversal. Today we're talking about machine learning and in particular linear discriminant analysis, or as I refer it from now on, LDA. We'll look at what is LDA, what is it trying to achieve, and the different mathematical and ideas as a whole that it applies and how does it work. I won't be getting too much into the mathematics, even though I'll show them, because I really would like us to see how does it work, why we're doing what we're doing, and what are the effects of the different approaches to our data. So first of all, let me tell you that if you're looking for overview of what machine learning is, artificial intelligence, how do they work, different high level ideas and methods that are used, you know, neurons, neural networks, I would advise you to look at my previous videos on machine learning, which are in my technology and innovations playlist, which is linked in the top right of your screen in the card section. And so are the videos, and there you can also see a very simple and visual example with code and pretty pictures of a simple linear regression model where I explain basically how machine learning works. So just to remind ourselves, as we said in the previous videos, we looked at simple linear regression. And what linear regression does is it tries to map some kind of continuous input variable or variables in higher dimensional space to an output variable. So basically, it tries to approximate some kind of function that maps input to output. And as you can see on the picture, it is continuous. That's why it's called regression. While for LDA, we apply it on a data set that has some kind of most of the time small or just limited amount of output classes. And as you can see here in the pictures, they are represented two classes. In the example that I'll show you in a moment, there are also two classes. In my next video, I'll be doing LDA on the Iris dataset, where we have three output classes. And what it tries to do, as the name suggests, it's trying to discriminate, to differentiate between the different classes. So what it does is it's trying to find such vectors in the system space, as you can see here on the picture, that provide a better separation. So when the elements of the system are projected onto those new vectors, we can see the separation they provide. And here is a bad vector, and here is a very good vector that provides a good separation for the system. And most of the time, initially, we're trying to find, for example, here we have a two-dimensional problem. We try to find it two vectors, right? And when the system is reordered according to those vectors, with them becoming the new axes of the system, we get a better separation. So if some of the classes were overlapped, we'll get them better separated into the space. But LDA actually has one other characteristic that even makes it more useful. And that is, it's not only finds those good vectors, good directions into the space, but it also gives us the tools to grade them, to find out how useful they are, to find out how much of the information they contain. And by doing that, we can choose only the number of vectors that actually are meaningful, right? That actually provide meaningful information. And by doing that, we can reduce the dimensionality of the problem. For example, on the picture that you can see here, only this vector, the best subspace, will be chosen, and that reduces the problem from two dimensions to one dimension. Here it is the same thing, only that vector will be chosen, and again from two dimensions, x1 and x2, the problem will be reduced to only one dimension. And here we can see a better representation on that. And in the example later, I'm doing the same thing. And in the next video on the Iris dataset, the problem at the beginning is four-dimensional, and I reduce it to two-dimensional for better visual representation, and even to we'll see that even one dimension is enough to differentiate the classes. And as you can imagine, that is just enormous because it greatly reduces the amount of calculations on any derivative systems. And you know, here we are making obviously simple examples, but in the real world, we might have a system that's dependent on hundreds of features, on thousands of features, which means that it has thousands of dimensions, and we can reduce them, you know, by a factor of 10, of 100, of 1000, you know, it depends. And that is just huge. So let's get into how does LDA actually work and find those good vectors, okay? LDA uses a rule that's called the Fisher's ratio, and you can see it here. Basically, it tries to maximize the ratio of the difference between the means of the classes, which is on the top, and what that does is it tries to make those two center points of the different classes or distributions as far away as possible, which is very logical, right? We want them to be separated. The other thing that we need to pay attention to is the variances of the classes, which we can see on the bottom. And what that represents is how spread each class is. So as we can see, we're trying to maximize that ratio, meaning that we find the best trade-off between as far away means as possible and as condensed classes as possible, which logical will give us the best separation. And here again, we can see that best vector, right, into the two dimensions, into one dimension. When we reduce a higher dimensional system to one dimension, we can actually see its histogram, which is something very useful because it shows us obviously the separation between the red and the green class. It also shows us the mean, as we can see here, where the highest point is, and also it shows us how condensed, so the variance of the classes. Okay, so we looked at what LDA is trying to achieve and the main ideas behind it, but how does it actually does it? What is the maths and the approaches that it uses other than just some kind of abstract Fisher ratio? Well, here's my example, and I'll show you the code in a moment. As you can see, I have two classes, which is blue and green, and they are two-dimensional classes. So that's just, let's say, x1, and this is x2. So we have two classes in a two-dimensional problem, and I have called them the Gaussian distributions because the classes are basically random numbers with appointed means. Covariances are basically the variance of the classes, and of course count. So here we can see class A, this is its mean, class B, and this is its covariance matrix, or as we said, just variance, how spread the class is. And here I have 8 weights, which by weights I mean only just those vectors that we are trying to project our points on. Those are those directions. And here I have the histograms of my system projected onto those vectors, right? And very simple representation. Here is a histogram against vector 0. And here we can see it's 0, 5. And down here I have actually how the vector looks, right? Here it is the 0 and here is the 5. It is quite simple. But when we apply it to our distribution, if we put it something like here, we can see that when we project our points on it, we get that histogram, and it is not very good separation, right? So here I have just made 8 arbitrary directions trying to represent how good they separate the system. And we can see here we have better separation, here we have very bad separation, and we find out that actually with weight 7, we have the best separation. But this is just arbitrary, right? I have just picked those directions on random. This point represents the Fisher's ratio. And as I said, our optimal vector will have the highest Fisher ratio, right? The biggest difference between the means and the least variance. And here we can see that with vector 7, our Fisher ratio is almost 6, which is the highest from any other point, which again makes sense, right? Because we saw that with weight 7, we had best separation. And so the actual mathematical approach used for finding the optimal vector, this direction into the space, is by using the scatter matrices of our distribution. And I want you to remember that the maths is just formulas, right? We can see them always and we can just put them in there. But what matters is actually understanding what is happening and why we're doing what we're doing. And the scatter matrices of our system, of our distribution, gives us the eigenpairs, which is eigenvectors, right? And eigenvalues. And if you don't know what eigenvectors and eigenvalues is, I recommend you looking it on Wikipedia. There is a very good explanation. So here we can see our eigenvalue and our eigenvector. And as I told you, the LDA actually shows us how useful each vector is. And here we can see that we have 0, 0 eigenvalue. And the eigenvalue is actually what shows us how meaningful the vector is. The higher the eigenvalue, the more meaningful it is. So here we have 0, 0, which means that this vector is basically useless. Which means that we have the perfect separation only on one dimension, which is represented by this vector, by this direction. And here is just the optimal W vector, which is the same thing as you can see. Here is a representation of the optimized for separation Gaussian distribution, right? This is the same system as before, only it is shifted with our perfect vector being the axis. And here I took a screenshot of it, as you can see, and let me show you how it was in the beginning. So as you can see, it's the same distribution, only it is shifted a bit, right? And this is obviously in two dimensions. But if we had higher dimensions, for example, 5 dimensions, we obviously cannot plot it. But what LDA does, it is shifts, it changes our points in such a way that they have better separation. And here I have plotted the histogram against the optimal W. And as you can see, we have very high means, we have the least variances, and that results in best separation. And here I'll take a screenshot of it, and I will show it against my best separation for my random directions. The density of the points on the means is higher, and even though that, as you can see, the means are not as far away as here, the variances of the classes are much smaller, which again represents this best trade-off between the two things, and so grants us the best separation. And here is represented the optimal direction into the two-dimensional space. And as you can see, the Fisher ratio is over 6. So that's the maximum that we can achieve. And, you know, for our simple problem, it is very easy to see that direction that is something like what I'm doing at the moment with my mouse, you know. It is around optimal vector, which is why I chose it here. But, you know, when we're looking at higher dimensions, as we said, in the real world with hundreds of dimensions, it is basically impossible to just approximate it, right? Which is why LDA is very useful. This formula gives us the eigenpairs, which we later use to find our optimal direction. And you might ask, okay, but when do we apply the Fisher's ratio? Where the Fisher ratio is actually ingrained, it is part of this formula. SB is the between class covariance matrix, which is basically trying to make the classes as far away as possible, right? And SW is the total within class covariance matrix, which is basically trying to make each class as condensed as possible. We can see here that for between class covariance matrix, we use the means, and this is transpose. And for total within class covariance matrix, we use xn, which is basically the total mean of the whole system, and m1 and m2 here are the means of the classes as they are in SB. And later, we are basically trying to find W, this weight as code in machine learning, or just, you know, the optimal vector or the optimal direction. And we can find it by solving the eigenvalue problem represented here. As of code, I'll just skim it very fast. Here with this function, I am making the Gaussian distributions, as you can see. And here are my means and covariances. And here I actually use my functions to get my distributions. And here I plot them. We saw the plot down there. Later I group my two classes into separate lists, so it's just easier for me to access them. Here I create the histograms for each of the classes against the different weights. And here I create the histograms that we saw. This is our weights multiplied by our classes. We are plotting the histograms here. Finding the means and variances so I can calculate the Fisher ratio, which is represented by that. And here we can see it's the means and variances, and I plot it also, and then I start finding the optimal W. So here I have the means of the two classes, as we saw. This is basically M1 and M2. And I find my between class covariance matrix. So it's just Python, I'm using NumPy, but it's just that little formula here. There is nothing more to it, okay? And then I'm finding the total within class covariance matrix. Here I'm just creating my matrices. Here is for A, here is for B. And here I get my eigenvalues and eigenvectors by solving the eigenvalue problem. Here I just arrange them into pairs so it's better looking. And basically that's it. After that I plot everything and finding the optimal Fisher ratio, which we saw later. I know that there is a lot more code, but I'll look at it in my next videos, where I'll show you LDA for the Iris dataset, which is four-dimensional problem with three classes. And later I'll also show you logistic regression, which is something very interesting and kind of is in between linear regression and linear discriminant analysis. I hope that this video was useful to you. I hope that we are getting a better understanding for what LDA is and how it works. And if you have any questions, please ask me down into the comments. I'll be happy to try to answer them for you if I can. And you know, stay universal, stay tuned. I have a lot of technology interesting videos, a lot of financial education, a lot of entertainment. So look around, Antiversal, it's all for you. See you next time.